Well, good afternoon. I'd like to welcome everybody to our regular Thursday lunchtime speaking series here. We're very fortunate to have a very good friend of mine personally, but more importantly, an icon of national security practice. Colonel John Collins did a complete career in the U.S. Army, starting in World War II. Service through World War II, Korea, and Vietnam. Distinguished assignments as a paratrooper, commanding a battalion in the 82nd Airborne Division, as well as, for all of you who recall back to 501, military operations and grand strategy, he was a planner, the plans officer for General Westmoreland in Vietnam. You know, this is a gentleman who was there on the ground and much of what you studied about. He also served many other distinguished assignments, including as a professor at the National War College, teaching national security strategy. So he is truly a practitioner and has all the theory and knowledge that goes behind it. But after his successful career in the Army, he joined the Congressional Research Service and served another complete career working on the Hill, testifying, and most importantly, writing some of the most important reports for Congress about our military. During the time of the Cold War, the balance of between the Soviet military and the U.S. military, reports on special operations. And during that time, he also authored the Five Soft Truths, which today, form the basis for special operations thinking and planning, with the most important one being humans are more important than hardware. He has written numerous books on military strategy called Military Strategy, on military geography called Military Geography. He is truly a distinguished national security practitioner. In about 1997, I think the Warlord Loop started, even after his retirement, he continued to be a leader in the national security field, and he started what's known as the Warlord Loop, and which is a group of about 500 national security practitioners that he brought together. Daily, they exchange ideas and information and debate the critical topics of national security. Now, John's going to talk today about career choices, talk about his experiences. You have his handouts there that he's going to talk to. But John is also someone that you can ask a question to, and he probably knows the answer. But more importantly, he will probably give you something to think about when you ask him about anything, including perhaps you might want to ask him about intervention, the kinds of things that you should think about for military intervention around the world, given what's going on today in Crimea. I'm sure he'll send me his principles for consideration for intervention, which we can provide for you. Now, John is a cancer survivor. He recently survived a bout of cancer, which has damaged his hearing. So he has a difficult time hearing, and so please bear with that. But his beautiful wife, Swift, is here, a marriage of 67 years.
No, 63.
63, sorry. Well, it will be 67 in a few more years. So she'll help when we have the question and answer period. We might have to repeat the questions, so Swift or I will do that. Please keep your questions kind of pointed so that we can get John to answer them for you. Keep that in mind. So without further ado, I'd really like to turn this over to a friend and mentor and truly an icon in the national security field, Colonel John Collins.
My first remark is, I have no idea why I'm here. I'm looking at my presentation in front of every chair, and so it reminds me of when I was a small boy back in ancient times. The movies used to have a little short subject called Follow the Bouncing Ball. And what it would be people singing, and the ones in the audience would sing along following the bouncing ball. So that's what you can do today. You can look at what you got in front of you, and you're going to be reading the same thing I am. Okay? A possibly related comment. I'm surprised and pleased no end to see how many women there are in this audience. This is really unusual in this particular topic, and so I feel great that you're here. I'm going to skip part of the first paragraph because you know all about Dave Maxwell. The subject is national security career choices, and I'm saying at the end of that paragraph must be at least 10,000 Sharpies who know more about that subject than I do, but I don't see any of them here today. So I feel very relaxed. What are my qualifications? Yogi Berra famously said, when you come to a fork in the road, take it. I've come to countless forks in the road during the last 93 years, and I've made countless choices, good, bad, indifferent. And the lessons I learned came too late to help me. But they haven't come too late to help you. So humor me, please. Pay attention. Take notes. Act like you really believe what I'm about to say is important. Choice one. Basic objectives. When Alice in Wonderland asked the Cheshire Cat, would you tell me please which way I ought to go from here? The cat's response was, it depends a whole lot on where you want to be. Where do you want to get to? So the first question you should ask yourself is, what do I want to be when I grow up? And neither education nor employment options fit any kind of a career pattern until you make that elemental decision. My son Sean, now 62 years old, his interest in outer space blossomed at age 9, 25 May 1961, when President Kennedy pledged to put a man on the moon and bring him back safely before that decade ended. Astronauts were Sean's heroes. He yearned to join that elite band of brothers, but failed because bottom lines on the eye charts looked blurry to him. I like to think that I helped shape his lifelong career by counseling him when he was a high school student. I said, these are the tough math, physics, other courses you have to take to make your dreams come true. And he complied. He culminated his academic career with a PhD in aeronautical and astronautical engineering at MIT. And now he's one of this nation's premier authorities on ballistic missile defense. I make a poor comparison. I wasted most of my youth. I dropped out of high school twice. I dropped out of college once. Past age 30 before I had the foggiest notion what the hell I wanted to be if I ever did grow up. St. Matthew finally showed me the light with words he wrote 2,000 years ago. He said, ye shall hear of wars, and rumors of wars. And I thought, how could anybody even imagine a more stable vocation? I mean, I said, send me in, coach. And I was light years behind my son Sean when he was 30 years old. Choice two, public or private service? Public and private service both provide a wide range of employment opportunities for national security newcomers who have to decide which venue best satisfies their aspirations and their purse strings. I'll hit a few high spots for consideration. Most public sector employees work for the federal government. Uncle Sam pays all the bills, and his representatives determine requirements. Individuals who opt for private service depend on non-governmental organizations for guidance and for compensation. Now, various surveys claim that the private sector pays best. You hear that a lot. Generalizations, however, are very, very difficult to defend, unless the duties are similar. There's no way, for example, to reasonably compare the responsibilities and pay of managers in Macy's basement. Compare those with U.S. political emissaries in Moscow, say, or military combatants who voluntarily lay their lives on the line when they're told to do it. We got an all-volunteer force, and they understand right up front, you may be dead when it's over. Sit down, shut your mouth, and do what you're told. Governmental employees, on the other hand, enjoy incomparably greater job security than the private sector. Probable risk versus gains accordingly deserves careful consideration before you decide whether you want to go public or you want to go private. In my own case, James Montgomery Flagg's famous Uncle Sam Wants You poster and an overdose of idealism helped me decide on public service before I enlisted as an Army private 72 years ago. That's a decision I've never regretted. The back cover of my memoir is entitled From Nowhere to Somewhere, published by a Vanity Press, depicts slight modification of the oath that Corporal Collins took as a second lieutenant, December 1942. I, John M. Collins, do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, that I take this obligation freely without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion, and that I will well and faithfully discharge whatever national security duties I perform, so help me God. Choice three, civilian or military? Budgetary problems currently prompt Congress to reduce federal expenditures. We're all well aware of that. Every military service will suffer till that trend reverses, which will not be tomorrow. National security, nevertheless, will remain a compelling U.S. interest in perpetuity. So well-qualified applicants like those in this room will continue to find opportunities for employment, of which the following selections are merely representative. Most U.S. citizens are well aware that the Department of Defense and its Army, Navy, Air Force, Marine Corps And the other subsidiaries, these have offer a wide range of command and staff billets in combat, logistical support, administrative organizations. And they have attractive promotion ladders for go-getters. If you ain't a go-getter, forget it. So there's something there for everybody who hankers to strut around in a military uniform. Not many are equally familiar with our Coast Guard. It belongs to the Department of Homeland Security. But it can pass to Navy control anytime the President says so, or in wartime if Congress directs. Its missions include search and rescue, maritime law enforcement. We're thinking of drug trade back and forth between here and South America. Aids to navigation, icebreaking. Icebreaking is becoming a big deal along with global warming because the waters are opening up in the north, in the Arctic. I spent a calendar year 1960 in Thule, Greenland, and I often wonder what would it look like if I go back now, because it was frozen solid most of the year, and I wonder what's happened. Well, the switch hitting National Aeronautics and Space Administration, which we all call NASA, performs civil as well as military functions. Armed forces benefit from reconnaissance, surveillance, missile warning, tracking, meteorological intelligence, navigation, communication missions benefit military and civilian. And everybody leans so heavily on NASA space satellites and ground installations that employment opportunities won't dry out during the foreseeable future. The State Department's Undersecretary for Political Affairs oversees 7 bureaus, a zillion embassies, another zillion consulates, entry and mid-level foreign service officers hopscotch from one assignment to another in assorted cultures that create a smorgasbord of challenges. Results prepare them to work productively with senior U.S. and foreign leaders of all political persuasions, the most valued players, master several languages well enough to conduct business, to negotiate agreements, to favorably represent this great nation's interests every day, often under extreme pressure. The Agency for International Development, AID, technically is part of state, but often pursues independent programs. And it has to have pretty much the same qualifications just mentioned. U.S. intelligence community. It's a coalition of 17 agencies, other organizations. It annually ranks high as one of the best places to work in the federal government. The employment opportunity to the CIA range from paper pushing to spook work. A lot of veterans applaud spook work because it gives them an adrenaline rush. Competent intelligence analysts put facts and figures together in context. They have to take cultural peculiarities into account. The estimators postulate short, mid, and long-range trends. Trends like, is North Korea going to remain a high-priority threat, or is it going to collapse? We've got a lot of people working on that every day, a lot of nights. Intelligence personnel assigned overseas, like the Foreign Service officers from the State Department, benefit immeasurably from street smarts and foreign language proficiency, including dialects, especially dialects. Arabic, Chinese, Pashto, Farsi, Korean, Russian, Japanese are in most demand today. Harvard's John Fitzgerald Kennedy School of Government lists more than 250 freelance think tanks, home and abroad. Some typified by the Brookings Institution, the Center for New American Security, Center for Strategic and International Studies, Institute for Defense Analyses, are widely respected. They're widely influential. A lot more are so narrowly based or biased that applicants would be very well advised to investigate their pedigrees before they decide they want to go that way. I'm particularly bullish about the Congressional Research Service on Capitol Hill. It's an educational beacon on Capitol Hill. And unlike any other organization anywhere in any country, to the best of my knowledge, its bylaws forbid, absolutely forbid, analysts to support anybody's policy or publicly occupy any position on the opinion spectrum. Members of the Senate and the House of Representatives consequently consider CRS reports as the current equivalent of Holy Scripture, and they seek private advice from CRS contacts and chambers. Choice four. You want to be a doer, or you want to be a thinker? War Just, while he was drafting his treatise entitled Military Men, 1970, asked Major General Samuel Coster, who then was superintendent of the U.S. Military Academy at West Point, he was asked, why don't U.S. Armed Services ever sire a strategic thinker comparable to Clausewitz? Never happened. Coster says, we're more interested in doers than we are in thinkers. I made a really dumb statement by that two-star educator, because doers seldom do as well as they ought to if you don't have thinkers helping them. Mindsets like Coster's still flourish, which is one reason why the current crop of U.S. military leaders and civilian policymakers generally become grand tacticians, practitioners of operational art, who win battles and campaigns but seldom excel at grand strategy, which wins wars. And we ain't won one since World War II. Which wasn't yesterday. That sad situation is not new. Strategic pioneers who create theories, concepts, and other intellectual tools for use by doers have been scarcer than hen's teeth throughout human history. Sun Tzu, Alfred Thayer Mahan, Little Heart, Herman Kahn, Bernard Brody, the world's first nuclear strategist. These guys are prominent exceptions to that rule. Lenin, Mao, Giap, Billy Mitchell, handful of others who practice what they preach, remain even rarer. Now, I think this is particularly interesting in this particular room at this particular time, because no woman, not even Joan of Arc, has ever occupied either category. I mean, who knows? The first female to terminate that trend may be right here in this room now. The lopsided imbalance between doers and thinkers, meanwhile, will persist until educators like General Coster encourage creative thinking, which Henry Ford called the hardest work there is. And then If they do that and potentates atop our national security pyramid don't reward their products, nothing happens anyway. Choice 5. Open mind or party line? Your choice between open mind and party line should be easy. Because individuals who paste right wing or left wing, liberal or conservative, hawk or dove in the middle of their forehead, abdicate any requirement to think. Reasonably knowledgeable students of national security affairs rarely need to heed anything they say, because most of their opinions are predictable. Professionals, as well as neophytes, nevertheless should review all sources with open minds, because nobody, other than myself, is always right, and nobody is always wrong. Party line proponents, intellectually rooted in concrete, additionally tend to respond sluggishly to radical changes that, in accord with Murphy's laws, can take place at the worst possible times and places. Rear Admiral J.C. Wiley, little gem called Military Strategy, A General Theory of Power Control, contains a plea for adaptable concepts and forces, because nobody other than God can consistently predict the onset, the scope, the tenor, the intensity, the course and consequences of any collision on the conflict spectrum, from nonviolent competition to military wargasms. Requirements therefore exist for a rucksack full of policies, plans, and programs designed to facilitate smooth transition in emergencies, because, as Wiley put it, planning for certitude is the most grievous of all mistakes. Choice 6. Be a problem solver or a complainer. President of the United States, Secretaries of State and Defense, the JCS Chairman, Service Chiefs, Combatant Commanders, all lack institutional ways to generate and sustain creative reactions, chain reactions of creative thought. They haven't got any way to do it. That they need it, though. They could use this to solve strategic, operational, tactical, logistical, budgetary, countless other pressing problems. Autocratic restrictions, built-in biases, compartmentalization, enforced compromise, security classification, refusal to talk to each other. All of these make routine reliance on non-resident thinkers imperative, absolutely imperative. And who knows you in that particular context is even important, more important than who you know. You've got to be out in Macy's window. You've got to be known to people who make the decisions. Doesn't make any difference how smart you are or how well you do your work. If they don't know who you are, nothing happens. What's the best way to attract favorable attention? By submitting opinion pieces to your national security periodicals. Don't let rejection and lack of recognition discourage you, because Rome wasn't built in a day. I just thought that up. My first 4 professional articles disappeared into black holes, never seen or heard from again. Others expired in editors' offices. Anonymity disappeared almost immediately after I expanded my National War College syllabus into a primer entitled Strategy for Beginners, which received nine pink slips before the Naval Institute Press published it in 1973 as Grand Strategy, Principles and Practices. The August 8, 1975 issue of Economica, Politica, Ideologica in Moscow praised that book for fundamental research carried out in this complex, multifaceted, and contradictory field. Oh God, I ate that up. I almost had it enlarged and pasted on the wall of my bedroom. Other plaudits followed at home and abroad. Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Spanish editions appeared. First to them without any regard for copyright. Russian translation of my military geography opus joined that collection. Many of my CRS reports and issue briefs made headlines around the world after I established the equivalent of I-call, U-haul relationships with a slew of really heavy-hitting journalists, many of whom I still have contact with after all these years. You folks can do better, armed with one or more diplomas from this highly respected university. Sharp pens, sharpened swords, a brief tutorial in the May-June 2006 issue of Military Review might expedite your acceptance as a noted national security author. There's a copy of it right in front of you. I think it's splendid. It compares pluses and minuses of 15 pertinent outlets that vary considerably with regard to frequency of publication, clientele, contents, and it terminates with writing tips that I've assembled during the last several decades. You don't have to take several decades. Take a look at it and see what you think. Choice 7, specialist or generalist. Be relaxed, stay cool. Choice 7 is the grand finale. Most national security professionals open and close their careers as specialists. They figuratively dig political, military, economic, sociological, psychological, technological, you name it, dig post holes in those narrow fields. Generalists who plow fields are a mile wide and a quarter of an inch deep. But they possess speaking familiarity with all or most of the specialties. Their mission is to help the President of the United States, Congress, subordinate decision makers, and their advisors, help them put myriad pieces of gargantuan national security puzzles together properly. Put them together with some idea of what the picture ought to look like when they're finished. The transition from specialist to generalist usually takes years, but it's not too early to make that your ultimate aim, provided you persevere. Stay with it. Being a generalist is the big deal. Don't ever forget it. My personal trek from national security specialist to generalist began when I was an Army captain in 1950. It lasted much longer than Mao's long march, which consumed merely 366 days. A strategic intelligence stint in the Pentagon as the U.S. Army's Arab-Israeli desk officer came first in 1950. 2 years later, the Army sent me to the Far East at theater level. Major Collins thereafter sampled operational intelligence, the 18th Airborne Corps, then learned a bit about tactical intelligence with the 82nd Airborne Division. Lieutenant Colonel Collins, unexpectedly became an operational planner at Fort Bragg during the Cuban Missile Crisis, 1963. And I continued on that track as a colonel in Vietnam, being chief of General Westmoreland's campaign planning group. The biggest thing I did at his request was to prepare a plan to block the Ho Chi Minh Trail in Laos. Block it during the dry season with a wet season on each end, and you blocked it for 18 consecutive months. I really thought I'm going to see my name in lights until Lyndon Baines Johnson gets on international TV in living color and said I quit. And that was the end of that. The plan finally got published in a national security publication years afterwards, but it didn't have any effect whatsoever. Did my crazy quilt pattern make me non-marketable? Not at all. On the contrary, each of those Alice sequence assignments served as a building block before 51-year-old civilian Collins became senior specialist in national defense at the Congressional Research Service. That assignment demanded generalist capabilities near the apex of this nation's national security apparatus. The Accidental Strategist, which Joint Force Quarterly published in April 2010, traces my trip from top to bottom and back again. Wrap up. God, wrap up. Thus far are the words of today's Holy Gospel. I hope that guardian angels heap good fortune on you who opt to become national security professionals. Your names will not appear on lists of the world's wealthiest individuals, but as I discovered eons ago, service to the United States of America in any capacity is more than compensatory. Thanks for humoring this old man. I commonly go by the moniker Geriatric John. Dave Maxwell will act as my interpreter-translator because I'm deaf as a stone. He's taped a transcript of this presentation on the off chance that any of you or anybody else in this university might request a copy. And he can furnish my professional writing tutorial right here, which could lead you to some shortcuts. I await your questions with trepidation. Well, obviously, the first pitfall is knowing your subject. More often than not, it's going to require time-consuming research, a lot of it, and it is going to require looking at every particular point of view on any particular subject. Like I said in this little presentation, that nobody is always right and nobody is always wrong. So you look at everything, you shake it all up in a hat, and you come out with your presentation of that particular topic. That's the first thing you need to do, is have impeccable research underpinning what you're about to try to publish. I'm not sure I can think of another one that's nearly that important. You're looking at a guy, by the way, who at age 93 still doesn't know how to type. I do all of my typing on a computer, which I didn't have one until I retired from CRS. I do all my typing with the index finger of my right hand. I don't even use two fingers. I read about 30 words a minute because I can't move my lips any faster. And so research It is a brutal task for me. It cannot possibly be that brutal for you.
How important is publishing if you want to be a doer, not a thinker?
How important is publishing if you want to be a doer and not a thinker?
You can't beat it. If you don't publish, I'm back with who knows you is more important than who you know. And so getting your name in print, despite all of the failures, the weeping in the night, get your name in print in this particular field. And that's why I think the sharp pens sharpen swords. It may be useful to you because it gives 15 different possibilities, of which there are at least 15 more, okay? And you decide which one of these is best likely to give you the exposure you want, and then dabble around with them. Of the 15, I've had stuff published in 13 of them. Being known is immeasurably important. Keep it in mind always.
And I would add, number 16 is your own Georgetown Security Studies Review, your own peer-reviewed journal. So you've got opportunity to publish right here as well. I can't emphasize that enough, all the great work that you students do. So we have our own journal that's peer-reviewed, student-runs. Next question.
One point. Sitting right here is a great man who is a member of the Warlord Loop. And the Warlord Loop, 7 days a week, with 500 members who cover the whole spectrum of thought, from the lunatic left to the radical right and everything in between, you can ask him questions about what are the various views of this particular issue at this particular time, and I'm sure he'd be glad to answer you. He ought to, it's his job, you see.
Next question.
Looks like I've milked it.
Well, I got one more for you, John. Now, could you talk about your principles of intervention?
Principles of what?
Intervention. Intervention. Since we are so focused on Ukraine and Crimea today, can you give...
Have you got a copy of this on your computer?
Yes, sir.
Okay. When I was at CRS on Capitol Hill, one of my many reports was called The Principles of Intervention, Military Intervention. And it goes through point A, B, C, D, E, F. This is how to think about it before you decide what you want to do. This has been disseminated widely, not just in the United States, but in a lot of other countries. You hear constant complaints right now by hardliners who are wondering, what in the world is this idiot Barack Obama doing? He's the president of the United States. Why didn't he do something about Crimea? Why didn't he do something about Ukraine? And a lot of them think military options are what he ought to be seriously considering. This little piece on the principles of intervention give you a way of thinking about how to go from national security interests to threats to objectives to overcome those threats right down the line, bing, 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 with, for each one of them, four questions, of which you could make 40 questions if you wanted. But it is a guide to how do you think what you want to do with regard to military intervention before you take action, that you may indeed be sorry you ever did it. Okay, the answer to that question is, I'm very antsy about things I read in the paper and I listen to on TV or the radio and say we've got to expand our special operations forces. Well, the special operations forces are special because they're not very big and because they have tremendous training time to make them real special operators. You cannot, in an emergency, expand rapidly. And if it's not an emergency and you expand too much, you have hurt yourself rather than help. There is an unknown but small limit to the size of special ops forces. And you need very much to think, what do you want them to do? Now, I will send to David Maxwell another little piece that you folks may find interesting. It's a presentation I delivered at Fort Bragg on special ops, all aspects of. For example, how do military special operations, how should those forces dovetail with CIA? It covers a whole slew of things that would probably be well worth listening to. So I will send it a copy to Dave, and anybody who wants it, all I got to ask him.
And we'll put together.
Incidentally, I spent less than a year in the special ops community. I never wore a Green Beret. I was never a SEAL. But I was with the special ops outfit in Paris, France, that was overseeing all the special ops in Europe back in the 1960s. And it was an experience that I still treasured.
We will put together a package of all of these, of what you have here, as well as intervention, as well as his soft talk, and we'll send that out actually to the entire class.
So, your mission.
Yes.
Remind me to send him this special
out.
It's actually been, some of his work has been published on Small Wars Journal. That piece is there as well, but we'll put together everything and send that out.
My last comment. I picked this one before it lost its baby fat. We've been at it now. We call it a life sentence. We've had it now for 63 years. We can't, either one of us, count the times when we've been right on the edge of a double axe murder, but we're still at it.
All right. Well, with that, please, everybody. There hasn't been one committed, so. But with that, please, everybody join me in saying, warmly saying thanks to John for giving this great presentation.